Huge excitement for us. Thursday evening, India time, 6 p.m. We've got a legend. We've got a real... I mean, this is big for me, for my generation. And when I say that, there's no disrespect for the man coming in because he's going to be a legend forever. But I hope Indian cricket lovers and sports lovers across the world remember one thing. Today's hero is built on the shoulders of yesterday's hero. So you cannot let go of the past. Without that, we have no future. Oh, I sound beautiful, like a real poet. Anyway, quick rant before we bring in the legend. I won't disclose his name yet. Naomi Osaka. World number two, I would say world number one, forget those rankings, makes something like $50 million to $100 million a year. Then talks to us about depression and this pain and that pain and how she can't take criticism from the press and how her clay court record is not good and she doesn't want those questions to be asked at the French Open. And so walked out of the process and said, I won't do it. And then was fine. And then, of course, left the tournament in tears and with her depression. Well, here's my point. You're earning that kind of money. Is it really that difficult to handle a couple of questions, mostly in some foreign language? I mean, is it that difficult to just take in a sledge here or there and a question? How hard can it be? 100 million. I would answer questions all day. I would do anything to be Naomi Osaka. I already have the upper body for it, but we won't discuss that. Let's go back to the man, the myth, the one and only. Great pride. And ironically, as a Parsi bowler, has been selected in that entire circus of 79 people who are touring England. But I know it's something. We go back to the arguably the biggest name from the Parsi community to ever play the game. And let me just say, a guy who changed the game, but people perhaps don't know that his style of cricket was the future when he came into bat. He may have not known himself. He was ferocious, aggressive, very different from typical Indian performers of the 60s and 70s. And here he is at Manchester, far, far away. It's Farokh Engineer. All rise, show respect. Farokh, give them 2 minutes. Everyone has to stand and salute you by law.
Tali maro, tali.
Tali maro and gali band. Let's be very clear. Farokh, no jokes apart, what a great honor this is for me. I know I've known you a little bit here and there over the years at various events and things. And, you know, I, from drunken nights when I come and drive you nuts and tell you how great you are and ask you for stories and bring 20 people to for you to regale us. You must understand that the love and respect is genuine. And the pride is fantastic. You know, I'm always correcting people about your name. I just did it with my team. Farokh will be here. I said, he's not Farokh. He's Farokh. Okay, Farokh. And maybe them say it 5 times each.
Well, so said, that's well been, said.
You know, 100%. You better Farokh, know that bloody...
Farokh becomes a Mia Bhai, you know.
Yeah, and exactly. Yeah, which is fine if you were born Farokh. So,
but certain... my name is still spelt in Indian papers. Huh? All our Indian papers as F-A-R-O-O-Q-U-E. Miani lal topi bhi pehra hai. Well, I'm very proud to be a Parsi. I mean, I'm nothing against... You know, any religions, but my actual correct name was F-A-R-R-O-K-H, Farokh. But they were mixing up double R and double O and double Q. So I said, let me make it simple, F-A-R-O-K-H. It's not that correct. Difficult. Even for a Parsi, it's not that difficult, is it?
No, it's not. And for the record, my dad is the same name, born in the same year, 1938.
I know your dad very well, by the way. Give him my very warm regards.
No, he's not doing too well. But he's, you know, well, that's a lesson for another day. But thank you so much, Farokh. And now let us start the engineer show. We want to go back and look at your life as quickly as possible. I mean, there were like, I think, close to 50 test matches, two or three test centuries, and some fascinating highlights, I mean, which you would tell us as well. But one thing I always wanted to ask, you nearly got 100 in one session, but did you really not know that you were like 94 or 95 not out?
Oh, yes, I knew it because the scoreboard is there as big as the... But the thing is, I was 92 with two overs left before lunch. And the way I was going, I was easily going to get it even with one over to spare.
Right.
The first ball of the second last over, I hooked Wes Hall. And Rohan Kanai, a deep fine leg, dived full length. And, you know, the ball ricocheted off his hand. We could have easily got two runs. But Dilip sir, they say, noko, noko, noko. So we had only one run there. And he blocked the other five balls. I thought, okay, the last over, Charlie Griffith, extra cover drive, Clive Lloyd, of all people, one of the tallest guys in the bloody team. He dives full length, and the ball again ricochets off his cousin. And I called for a second run, but what reply did I get? Nako, 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 nako. I'm not blaming Dilip. Huh? He's a wonderful person. Rest in peace.
But you were great buddies. Yeah.
Of course we were. But I just couldn't understand. I think that camaraderie and the teamship that is there these days perhaps was was a bit lacking those days, you know. And I don't want to dwell on that, but I was very happy to be.
So when I came
at lunchtime, everyone's saying, "Arey, sala, so kyun nahi banaya before lunch? Only Bradman has gotten McCartney or something." But so the first ball after lunch was Lance Gibbs, an off spinner. Sala code bouncers and beamers all morning. This fellow coming and tossing the ball up. I said, "It's either you or me, pal." And he went straight out of the ground for six. I think the ball is still traveling as we talk, you know. Never found the ball.
But, yeah, there you go. But coming back to Cyrus Says for a second, so didn't you ask him in between? I mean, after blocking one, wouldn't you tell him, "Let's marrow a single here so I get the strike"?
No,
would not even do that.
You don't
have
today's
batsman guides the other batsman to reach the 100.
Yeah, but I mean, it's common sense. Okay, you're going to take a single and give the batsman a strike. The guy who's informed on the day, you give him as much strike as possible, which is an unwritten law. I'm not blaming Dilip Sir. They said, don't get me wrong at all. Huh? He was a very fine cricketer. He did great deeds for India. But it was just, he perhaps couldn't get a single. I'm sure he must have tried to. But we're talking about some of the fastest bowlers in the world who tried to kill you first and then get you out.
And Charlie Griffith, if I'm not mistaken, had a bit of a illegal... Yeah, there you go.
Oh, yeah. Well, a chucker, without any doubt.
Proper bent elbow.
They made it very clear. We want to see blood on batsmen's faces. You know, they tried their best to get you out, but if they didn't, I mean, they tried to kill you. That was their motto. Because we didn't
And you guys had to face... Farokh, you had to face unlimited bouncers, if I remember correctly.
Oh, yeah.
There was no limit, two bouncers per over.
No limit of bouncers. But Cyrus, the helmet, the box, you know, the batsmen wear, the pink plastic box that we wore to protect our crucial, you know.
Right. The better part of manhood.
You said it. So that box was invented first in 1876. The helmets came into force only in 1976. Cyrus, could you tell me why it took 100 years for batsmen to realize the brains are just as precious as the balls?
Or maybe not.
In some cases.
Yeah. Were you as fast with the bat off the pitch, now that you mention it? Because I've heard legendary stories of that too. Perhaps the gentleman may not answer.
Yeah. Sorry, was that?
I'm saying off the pitch, was your bat as quick? Because I've heard many stories about you, the original glamour boy. I mean, the whole generations have not... Perhaps the gloves, not known.
The gloves didn't do a bad job. Let's put it that way.
The gloves, you picked up everything, is what you're saying.
No.
Nothing went by. Let's go for it, Farokh. We're Bawas at the end of the day.
Ek divorce to sahelo cha.
Oh, theek cha, thank you, away. Not to worry.
I mean, the thing is that there were actresses who used to literally throw themselves.
Names, Farokh, engineer.
You needed a lot of willpower to...
To let the ball go past the off stump. You won't name names. That'll be fabulous. Come on. I'll have to think 60s and 70s.
Because
Madhubala and that kind of generation.
Some of them are alive and kicking. And it wouldn't be...
Zina Daman.
It wouldn't Parveen
be... Babi.
Wouldn't be cricket.
Wouldn't be cricket. All right. Fair enough. Okay. With that out of the way, let's go back to the beginning, because the interesting part of is your entire tale. I was just trying to find out a little bit about the background. Dad was a doctor.
My dad was a doctor, and he was called Dr. Engineer all his life.
Which is...
The thing is, you don't see the funny side of it growing up. But later on, you think, you know, how... It can only happen in our bowers, you know?
True.
Dr. Parsi. And of course, there's... But my early days, my schooling was in Don Bosco High School, which was a Makapown school, you know.
But brought up lots of cricket talent, right?
Later. But
yeah. Ravi Shastri.
Ravi Shastri, Dilip Mahisagar, they all followed my Sanjay Manjrekar, all followed my footsteps and joined Don Bosco and went to Podar College. Lovely story about me joining Podar College. You'll please remind me about that later. But Don Bosco, my classmate was Shashi Kapoor. On my same, not only the same class, but same bench. And they were a duffer bench. So kindergarten to 10th standard, we were on the same bench as best of friends. Yeah. You know, he lived in Matunga and, you know, I was in Dada. And we weren't the best of students. On the last bench, we were yapping away as students do. And we had this professor called Lobo, Mr. Lobo. a French teacher. And you know the heavy dusters on the wooden boards, the very heavy dusters. He used to have a crack aim. He would have made a great cover point for India, I think. He used to fling those dusters, and so accurately he used to hit the bloody heads. And he's bled so many pupils. Aajkal to nahi chale wo, you know.
But what happened to the famous engineer gloves? Did you?
But they thana kyaot ne? Because Sashi was my classmate. We were yapping away, and from the corner of my side, I saw this huge duster hurtle right towards Shashi's face. And must have been a split second decision that I put my hand out and I took a catch, my first diving first slip catch ever, I think, you know, would have hit Shashi right in the middle of his eyes. And I used to always joke with Shashi, because sala tere ko daku ka role milta tha, you know, if the duster had hit you, it would certainly disfigure you. And he used to always, we always used to have a good laugh about it.
But wow.
That was my first slip catch, you know.
Your first slip catch, but Dr. Radhi Banyu, and that's the interesting part, because I would think there'd be pressure coming from a medical background.
My dad, mom and dad dearly wanted me to be a doctor. I was very keen on flying. So I got a pilot's license and I wanted to join the Air Force. But a little thing called cricket got in the way. And by that time, you see, I didn't play any serious cricket while at school. I played for Parsi club, which hardly gave me a chance. You know? So the more at university. You know, I was at university. I was in college by the age of 16.
So Podar College is where it all happened, right?
Podar College was a very unfancied college. You know, all the pretty girls went to Sydenham and Xavier's and Elphinstone and all that. So, I mean, my intention was naturally to follow the pretty girls. You know,
what went wrong?
Professor Changadkar came to me and said, Farokh, I want to build up a team in Podar College. You know, around you, we will give you free ship in the college, which is a great incentive. I thought I'd been a burden to my parents all my school days and all that. So at least let me. And then he came up with a trump question. He said, how have you fared in your SSC exam? You know, I said, all right, but why do you ask? He said, if you give me your word that you'll join Podar College, I'll make sure that you pass in your SSC exam. And so I was like, wawa. I was at a cigar.
This is like match fixing. Yeah,
all my friends. I told him I've already passed. I don't remember you guys, you know. But I gave my word to him. I went to Podar College, really unfancied college those days. But we built a cricket team around it. We became the intercollegiate champions eventually. And now Podar are one of the best colleges in town, really, you know, to.
So you started this legacy that brought Shastri and Manjrekar and Wingsakar and all these fancy names.
And they told me, I mean, even up now, actor who's from King Circle, forget his name now.
Let's call him actor from King Circle.
Yeah, very famous. One of the absolute very famous. Shahrukh Khan.
Generation
Khan.
Before.
Akshay Kumar.
Akshay Kumar. He's from King Circle.
Yeah, originally from there. So he told me he joined Don Bosco just because I was there, you know, of course, much later. But it was lovely to have the legacy and all that.
Yeah, but one thing is true. All colleges, the famous faces, they stay generation after generation. Everybody explains, I'm from Podar, Farokh Engineers College. That's a normal thing. I think that's fair enough.
Which is nice.
But what? Tell us about the cricket structure there. So were you opening the batting or that only happened for India later?
No, only happened later.
In the middle order.
I started opening because nobody else, wanted to open against the West Indies.
Yeah.
You know, which is an absolute fact. You know, but the injured, fever, you know, so I was
without naming names, huh?
Without naming names, absolutely.
But they actually put their hand up and said, "Ki I can't go out to bat."
Tap chair, ki pag dukhe, you know.
What are you saying?
I'm not well. I mean, you're talking about a hard cricket ball comes hurtling at you at over 100 miles per hour. They bowled over 100 miles per hour those days. I just took 94, 95 miles per hour, then they get an orgasm. Such a fast bowler. Sala, in our time, they were well over 100 miles per hour.
This is a very controversial point. We must talk about it for a second. You're telling me that...
There were no speed guns. Hall and Griffith. Over 100
Roy Gilchrist, who was the crazy one?
Griffith had a bad action, a chucker. And yeah. there was another guy, another Pagal solo Jamaican lorry
Gilchrist,
driver
Gilchrist.
Called yeah. Roy Gilchrist.
Correct.
Now, they openly said, okay, we'd love to see blood on batsmen's faces, you know, and if we get them out in the meanwhile, well and good. But they were sort of almost like sadists. I mean, they made it very clear when he came out to bat. You know, okay, there was no nonsense. So, I mean, and Nari Contractor, our Parsi captain, got hit in Barbados. Hit a hit on the skull by a ball that didn't rise as much as it should have, you know. And he was so unfortunate that he got hit. But I'm so glad that he had a titanium skull, which is stronger than all our skulls. And he's recovered well. Never really played much after that. But a great man, my captain, and huge respect for Nari Contractor. But I mean, after that, nobody was too keen to open against these idiots, these fast bowlers who try to kill you. So the test match in Chennai, I was told, Farokh, the only way you can get in the team was by opening the innings. But I said, I've never opened before. You know, khelna hai ki nahi khelna hai bhai. So opened, and I was determined that they can only bowl one ball at a time. They've got a ball in their hands, I've got a bat in my hand. You know, dalo it, jitna fast dalo, I was lucky I had a very good eye. And I preferred bouncers and beamers to bowlers coming in bowling slow, bloody outswingers and all that. You know, I preferred speed because the quicker they come, the quicker they go. And all the bat fielders are behind you. So there are big gaps to lift the ball all over the place, you know. So I said, right, I'm going to take them on. And I took them on. And with God's grace, I came out. And then the next tour was, after that, that changed my whole life completely because I was invited to England to play for, you know, as a professional. I was the very first Indian to be invited to play professional county cricket. There were many before me, Polly Umriga, Vinu Mankad, Ramchand, they played Lancashire League, which is a huge difference. There's one professional and the rest 10 are butchers, bakers, farmers, candlestick makers, whatever. Here is Khaddus, 11 professionals against 11 professionals. You're playing against the top of the world's cricketers there. So county cricket is a very high standard. I was the first for many things, the first Indian to be asked to model for products.
Apparently you were quite the sex symbol. Some of the older ladies have told us.
To be old lady.
What was with the sideburns?
I know they've gone grey. They're still there. But to be invited to model for Brill Cream, only two people were invited before me. It was Dennis Compton, who was a double international cricketer.
Footballer.
And Keith Miller of Australia. You know, real flamboyant. And I was the third person to be invited. To be invited to model for Brill Cream was like me on the front page of Vogue magazine those days.
Yeah.
Because after me, there was David Beckham. That is the sort of pedigree that Brill Cream had.
So let's get this right. For 40 years till David Beckham came along, it was Farokh Engineer with the Brill Cream.
I didn't model for 40 years, but you know.
I'm just kidding. Yeah. But Farokh, tell us what happens in the dressing room because you suddenly became a superstar. You know, like you said, Lancashire reaches out for you. Everybody wants you.
There were
four English counties fighting for you.
They weren't fighting too much. but they'd offered me contracts.
What did the others feel? Was there any kind of, were they jealous? Was there
It's a huge honor to be invited to play in England, professional county cricket. And there were four counties chasing me. So, but I'd almost qualified for the Jet Squadron then, you know. And as I said, a little thing called cricket got in the way. So my mum was very, very, you know, sort of cautious with me. She knew she had a reckless son. And few of my guys in my batch had died in plane crashes, you know, in training. So she said, no, definitely you're going to play cricket. So, I mean, I accepted the contract. G.R.D. Tata, the great G.R.D., bless his soul, I'm privileged to say hugely that he was a very dear friend of mine. He got to know me because the hobby of flying and sports, he loved both. And I was a Tata employee through and through. So he recognized that. So I asked his advice. I showed him the contract. He just smiled and said, Farokh, I know how much you earn in telco, you know, here or Tisco. And this is like,
in another league.
10 times your, you know, what you're going to earn here. Go for an initial three-year contract. Just go for a three-year contract or more, but learn some trade. I did my BCom, you know. After that, he said, learn your trade, get specialized in some subject. The House of Tartars will always have a senior position for you.
Wow.
So to hear that from someone like JRD gave me so much confidence that Kulli Chhatiye, I agreed to play for Lancashire.
I think that's fabulous. I think I'm going to write to Ratan Tata immediately and ask him if he, for all of us who are in flexible careers, which can end at any point, if the House of Tartars will take us back in. I don't know what special skills I can offer. We're joking around, but you go to Lancashire, you're an Indian boy. There, what was it like initially? Did they accept you? Was there any sort of racism or fitting in?
India have always been a third-rate country for the Angrez since the days they were ruling us. You know,
what the hell does that mean?
That complex was always there, that the English are our masters. And I decided from day one to sort of reject that thing straight away. I wanted to show them I'm not equal to them, but I'm superior to them. You know, I'm...
Farokh, that's racism. It's reverse racism.
No, I know.
Okay, fair enough. Go ahead.
I decided that I was going to be respected, not for my color or for my, you know, where I come from, but I'm going to play the game, not as good as them, but much better than them, because I've been specially invited as the overseas professional. I've been, you know, they have had that confidence in me. So from day one, I made a huge impact, both in batting and wicket keeping. And you learn, you earn their huge respect. You know, at Pelle, that there was one or two people that said, oh, India, yeah, you know, third rate in cricket. Why are they asking Indian guys? So many Australians or South Africans, white, could have come. But I soon changed the thing. And after my first year, mind you, I was invited along with Gary Sobers, the world's finest all-round cricketer. And Gary Sobers couldn't come to Lancashire because he wanted Lancashire to pay off his betting debts. Huge gambler.
Yeah.
So Lancashire refused to do that, but Nottinghamshire agreed. So he went to Nottinghamshire. So I came in as number one overseas player. I had to recommend another overseas player for the next year. And I recommended Clive Hubert Lloyd.
Oh, that's
and
how
he
it
was
happened.
He was my roommate for the next 10 years. Can you imagine? The only one who's ever given me an inferiority complex.
I knew you'd go there. I knew you'd go there.
Was when the Clive Lloyd came out of the showers. I said, cover the bloody thing up, I said.
it was a Schlesinger, was it?
No, no, Bob.
Duncan Fernley.
I said, cover the bloody thing up. But we got along great. You know?
And he was your successor in a sense. Did he captain Lancashire as well and go on to become the next icon?
Yeah. But I was a year senior to him. And he always thanks me for recommending him to Lancashire. One of our selectors was Mr. Washbrook, Cyril Washbrook, the great cricketer himself.
Opener, right?
Yeah. He said, but Farokh, he wears glasses. I said, never mind his glasses, Mr. Washbrook. Sign him on. And he won't regret it. And we had a great partnership together. We won everything. We were the Manchester United of cricket. You know, instead of Manchester United, only 100 yards away from Lancashire County Cricket Club. As you know, you've been to Manchester. So, I mean,
But you guys had your own rivalry with Yorkshire, the Roses. Isn't that, wasn't that the big one?
Oh, yes, still. Salo, and the main culprit was Jeff Boycott. Salo, ek number no cheat, ek number no.
Really?
Time and again, I've caught him out behind and he started, you know, instead of from his bat, he started rubbing his elbow and all that. But the ball has come off his bloody shoulder or his sleeve.
So Boycott never walked, huh?
No, never walked. And he got out. And some of the most boring bastards that I've ever come across. Most boring batsman ever. You know, some of took Rame and he used to tell the other junior players to hit the ball. I said, these young guys are playing for their careers, you know. Why don't you go? Oh, he used to tell me in Yorkshire lingo, nowt to do with thee. You know, typical Yorkshire.
Did you sledge him?
Oh, yeah, all the time. Yeah. And Dickie Bird, who was a very, very dear friend of mine and still is, used to always, his boycott used to complain to Dickie, look at rookies sledging me from behind the stumps. And Dickie used to say, cut it out, Farokh. When Boycott's back was turned, he used to wink at me.
Hey, come on, give us some Farokh engineer sledges, both in Marathi and Bombay cricket and in Lancashire and Northern England accent, whatever the hell you are to
my
use.
My Marathi is very good for a Parsi.
Yeah, I've heard you speak. Heard you speak at a function. I was just telling them offline.
With players like Wadekar, Gavaskar and all that. Yeah. I mean, I used to talk to
Gavaskar Marathi. Says your Marathi is better than his.
quite possibly true, yes.
Yeah.
But so what, good time.
What were the sledges?
Sledges, I mean...
MCBC? Nothing.
We received more sledges than giving it. It's the Australians who started it. You know, and I believed in answering with the bat or with the gloves, you know. But I never got personal, you know, or your mother or your daughter or something or your wife. No, I couldn't come down to that level. Let the Australians do it. But we...
Okay.
Cyrus, we were all bloody Indians before... We started being the economy of the world, and before the IPL started, we all bloody Indians.
Are you telling me the same
Australians and same South Africans and all that
who come here to ply their trade,
come here now to India and earn big bucks with IPL.
Boycott became a huge India lover. Never wanted to come here with the bat.
All of a sudden,
came as a commentator.
India, you know,
yeah.
Boycott has used the word bloody Indians actually. You know,
yeah.
And I've heard
him
say that. But and then when the money is round. These all become India fans all of a sudden, you know. So, Boycott, I was captaining a World 11 in Toronto. And we were returning back to Manchester on the Air Canada flight. And Boycott had a cricket bat in his hand. Mind you, he was an extremely boring player. The Canadian guy, you know, he said, I'm sorry, we can't let you carry that, you know, on the aircraft.
Yeah.
Consider that as an offensive weapon. And I had to quickly interrupt and said, Officer, you haven't seen him bat. I said, no. He ran after me with the bat at Toronto Airport.
Are these true stories? Is this a true story?
Absolutely true. Absolutely true.
Right. Give us some incidents from Lancashire and from Indian Test cricket. Because what was it like in the 60s and 70s?
I must tell you, in 1971, when he won the, you know, when he beat England,
this dual series.
We had a manager called Hemu Adhikari. You know, he was a colonel. Peanuts khawana bo shauk hota. I said peanuts, huh? You heard it wrongly.
Peanuts.
Peanuts. At Buckingham Palace, the function is there. The Queen and the Duke are waiting to come in, plush red carpet and all that. But, you know, we are there before Her Majesty, the Queen. And Colonel had just grabbed two handfuls of peanuts. You know, mutti marine, he was flicking them from all directions in his mouth.
Oh, no. Oh, come on.
Anyway, he had just grabbed two fresh handfuls. And the door is open and the Master of Ceremony announces Her Majesty the Queen. So naturally, the first person she greets is the manager. So she put her hand out. Hello, Colonel. You know, the Colonel had to mention wada. Peanuts in both hands.
You know, oh my God.
Then thank God he was a colonel, used his presence of mind. So he did tuck namaste. And as he did namaste, the peanuts were coming down on the floor, on the red carpet. Some even went in the queen's shoe.
And are you serious?
I'm serious. And he had peanuts. He had a mouthful of peanuts. And he had two handfuls of peanuts.
Wow.
So the Duke jokingly said, oh, Colonel, you like peanuts, don't you? And Colonel went,
An international incident. Were you just behind him in the line?
Yes. But Bijo incident.
Please.
They always tell you in the dressing room that the chairman invites you to the committee room after the day's play for a drink. It's a traditional thing. Every county does that. So the Lancashire chairman those days came and said, Colonel, would you and your boys like to come to our committee room for a drink? A drink doesn't mean alcoholic drinks. Of course, there's alcoholic drinks there, but you don't have to have an alcoholic drink. You can have a soft drink or whatever. The colonel, hell, jeeb barkariyani, the tharat thar lafa mariyan on a munapo. He said, well, my boys don't drink. Little did bloody know, boys. My boys don't. But he said, doesn't matter. I said to colonel, Colonel, soft drink, limbu pane bhi ho se tha, orange squash. Ah, then we'll come. Then we'll come. But at last, salah gilchodia se apre, you know. So would you come to the? It's an honor to be invited to the committee room for a drink, and it's a traditionally customary thing. But bolo jeep bar kare laugh hamare banda gal pa.
But your batch of 71 were hard drinkers. I mean, you had from.
I don't think anyone were hard drinkers, but we enjoyed a drink for sure. You know, and I must tell you, the same manager Adhikari, apro, we were staying at the Clarendon Court Hotel, and my room was next to him, because I was a captain or vice captain or something. Anyway, I knocked on his door to ask him something or to get, and door was open. So I said, Colonel, Cheoke Rumma, are you in the room? He was in the bathroom, and through the bathroom mirror, I saw a brandy bottle, and he was pot knocking down bloody neat brandy. And he always told us he was a teetotaler. I said, Colonel, the brandy pures the अरे बहुत सर्दी छे बहुत ठंडी छे बार यू नो इतने ज़्यादा तबियत ना वैसे मेडिसिनल रीज़न्स एंड द बोतल वाज थ्री क्वार्टर्स एम्प्टी सो फॉर मेडिसिनल रीज़न्स वाज डूइंग गुड जॉब
आई मीन फेयर इनफ
दिस आर फन स्टोरीज ही वाज अ लवली मैन नथिंग अगेंस्ट द पर्सन एट ऑल
हु वाज द वर्स्ट रूममेट यू हैड
क्लाइव लॉयड फॉर गिविंग मी एन इनफीरियरिटी कॉम्प्लेक्स
एंड अमंगस्ट द इंडियन बॉयज
No one was bad as such, you know. I mean, but the, you know, we all had a.
Had a but you were good... you were the prankster. They had to worry about you.
Myself and Patowdi were the two pranksters.
Give us a couple of them. Just a couple of.
Like we were in a place called St. Kitts in the Caribbean,
West Indies,
where there was a hurricane the year before, and it had destroyed the island completely and all that. So we went. We planned a dinner. You know, it was stormy weather and all that, you know. So I thought, could we have a little prank on the players? You know? There was no game the next day. So we got the receptionist to make a phone call to all the rooms. Okay, immediately put everything, your television thing and everything, phone and everything in the cupboard and come out as you are. Lungi par, chaddi par, bar, come to the reception area, kaina, because we're expecting a hurricane, kaina. Now, everybody was there except me and Tiger. I think they soon caught on. Can I just take this?
Yes, you can. Shall we take a break while you take your call? We'll take a quick break.
I'll
take your call. And we'll bring in Silvery quickly. Silvery is our producer, also a huge lover of cricket, but he hasn't ever played a match.
Yeah.
Farokh's on the phone, Silvery, so we thought it's a good point to take the break and somebody's driving him mad. Yeah. It's probably Clive Lloyd. All the stories you've told. Or Hemu Adhikari. One of the two. Oh, sorry. He's not there anymore. Yeah.
Does it lengthen any further?
Okay.
It was Antarish, it's lovely seeing you.
Hello, sir. How are you doing, sir?
You're obviously doing a very good job with Cyrus. You know, who wouldn't do a good job with Cyrus? Great man.
I've enjoyed
listening to you, Cyrus. I've enjoyed your skits and all that. And I've laughed. It's great to laugh.
Really? Yeah, you were just telling us.
Yeah.
No, you were just telling us about pranks, that you and Patowdi were known to be the naughty ones and they had to worry about the things you were up to.
Yeah.
But there's something you've mentioned. I want to just... apparently, you went on record to say that at the age of maybe 2 or 3 years back, that you still haven't used Viagra. Is that true?
No. It came in the papers that I died. You know, and I'm getting all sorts of phone calls. You know, and Sunil Gavaskar called me. You know, called my number, mobile number. And I thought I'll play a prank. Instead of saying hello, I went, ooh, like Bhutno Awaaz. You know? And then he was, Salah, mecha mazak mat kar yaar, are you alive? I said, yeah, of course I am alive and kicking. And this bloody journalist was persistent. He rung me about at least 15, 20 times. Mr. Engineer, am I really talking to you? I said, of course you are. You know, I mean... are you in good health? I said, I told you a dozen times that I'm in very good health. In fact, I'm in such good health that I'm 75 years old and I still don't need Viagra, I said. You know, does that enter your head how healthy I am? Just that next day, headlines in Indian newspapers, huge headline like this, Farokh engineer says I don't use Viagra.
And you know how they're upset and complex Indians from the age of 30 onwards who have started using it. So whether true or not, you screwed a whole generation and the next one as well, literally.
Yeah. I mean, but I was always known to take the funny side of things without offending anyone or without trying to offend anyone knowingly.
Silvery, note how Mr. Engineer has refused to answer the question, though. Huh? Yeah. He's told us the story, but there's no answer to the question.
About the pranks?
Whether you use or don't use.
Marathi mein kya aaj tu lik nahi.
Okay, we'll leave it there.
I'm 83 and never used.
And but never used. On record.
At the age of 93, I might think about it.
Yeah, there you go. By then you'll be endorsing Viagra. Can you imagine from Brill Cream to the journey has come full circle? But just I want to ask you one more thing. As a keeper, I always want to know what the conversation between first slip and keeper is. Just even watching Joe Root and Bracey right now on the television. What the hell do they do? What do you guys talk about?
Generally, you talk about the wicket, the batsman's weaknesses, strengths, the bowler's strengths and weaknesses. And usually you relate to the captain, you know. That's why wicketkeepers would always make good captains. Now, Pataudi and Wadekar were my Indian captains most of the time. And I would say, I could honestly say that I did about 80 to 90% of the captaincy because not one woo was made by them. They didn't have to actually come and talk. Just the eyes met and the bowling change or a fielder's position was changed and, you know, things like that. So, I mean, a wicketkeeper knows from behind the stumps what exactly is happening, what the pitch is doing, how much the ball is turning or swinging, what the batsman's strengths and weaknesses are. So you're in a great position from behind the stumps to advise. So that's the thing, the generally conversation take place. But between me and the first slip, we used to talk about how many blondes are in the stands, you know.
Who's the first slip? Wadekar?
Wadekar
has a naughty sense of humor.
I used to always, because you're all the time concentrating, so you got to let the steam off. And I used to let the steam off after every ball, almost, or whenever I could, you know, to see something funny side happen. Because before the next ball, you concentrate again. But in between, you just let the steam off and you're cool. That way you can concentrate more. I can, at least.
I'll explain to the bacha. Silvery, it's like coitus, like sex. You do and then you concentrate, then you go again, then you. So it's very similar. You're on off. Is that the right technique, Farokh? On off, Chena?
No, mine was always on.
Okay. Stop it. This show can't go any lower. We've got a legend. Let's talk cricket. There's so many other stories. I don't know how much time we have, but there's one about Hindi commentary with Kapil Dev. Apparently, legendary story.
Oh yes. Can you imagine getting a Parsi to do Hindi commentary? I mean, we were at Lord's and I was narrating an incident in 1983. By the way, the film is coming out.
Yeah.
Baban Irani is playing my part.
Yes.
As the
he spent a few days with you and he was completely, absolutely. I mean, he's in awe of you, both as a cricketer and as a drinker. He couldn't hold his own. Yeah.
But anyway, he was here. We had a marvelous time together. And in the
Hindi commentary.
I was the Hindi commentary. So Kapil Dev and I were talking while it was raining and the game was off. So we're talking about the 83 World Cup. When it actually happened, I was in the commentator's box and Brian Johnston, the British commentator, asked me, said, Farokh, would Mrs. Gandhi declare a public holiday? Would Mrs. Gandhi declare a public holiday tomorrow? I said, I'm sure she's an avid listener of Test Match Special, as if she has the time to do that. No? And I'm sure if she's listening, she will declare a public holiday the next day. And much to my surprise, within 15 minutes, we got a message through BBC headquarters and to the Lord's cricket ground commentator's box that Mrs. Gandhi has in fact heard your comments and declared a public holiday. So I told Kapil in Hindi, I said, meri to phat gayi yaar. My word. BBC, you know, the television company was inundated with calls. Get him off the bloody air. How can you use such language? I said, I didn't say meri kya phat gayi. I just said, meri to phat gayi yaar. As we talk, as I'm talking to you, you know. So Kapil also went like that. Kya bola tu? And that was the end of my Hindi commentating. by the way.
But in today's standards, that would not be so politically incorrect.
But Cyrus, you tell me, how else would a Parsi describe it?
I think it was spot on. It was a bang on. I think it's fair.
I didn't quite describe what Fadgai, but I just said,
exactly.
But that anyway, that was the end of my Hindi commentating days. But that, it was therefore getting a Parsi to speak Hindi.
No, I've heard him speak Silvery because all kinds of people approach him at bars and at events and all that. And some of them are more comfortable in Hindi or Marathi. Of course, Gujarati in English, he's far more comfortable. But he speaks decent Hindi, decent Marathi, and actually speaks correctly, in spite of all the things he's saying. This is the one that goes the other way as far as I'm concerned. I'd be able to read this ball. Farokh, let's quickly, because we've got these AMAs and there are lots of questions. Can you tell us the usual suspects? Who do you think was the best batsman that you've ever seen?
The best batsman, I mean,
Gary Sobers, Viv Richards.
That I played with, I would say, was Viv Richards. You know,
His first series you played, 75.
The one that I played with,
74, 75.
Sunil Gavaskar, I played with tremendous concentration, tremendous determination. You know,
Gavaskar, Richard
didn't like Sobers, Richards, but Viv Richards was the most flamboyant that I've ever seen. If you ask me who's the most greatest all round cricketer, I would say Gary Sobers. He was a very brilliant bowler, left-arm quick bowler. He bowled left-arm Chinaman. Brilliant batsman, brilliant closing fielder. He was the most complete cricketer ever. But purely as a batsman, I think Viv Richards.
Really?
Perhaps the great Rohan Kanhai would come near him. You know. And
wow. So you put them above Gary Sobers. Everton Weeks?
Purely as Everton. I didn't play with Everton Weeks. It was a bit senior to me. Hmm. But Weeks, Warren Walcott. If you ask me, one of the nicest human beings I've ever come across on a cricket pitch, I would say Frank Worrell, without a doubt. He was a great, 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 great human being. He died of leukemia at a very young age. And I was with him at Eden Gardens about a fortnight or so before he sadly passed away. And whenever I used to go to Barbados, I used to always take flowers and a carton of cigarettes for his wife, Velda, you know, Lady Worrell. Lovely lady. We used to go to Frank's grave and place some flowers there. I had so much respect for him.
Sir Frank Worrell was the first ethnic, so to speak, black captain of the West Indies. So he has a major role to play in the social aspect of cricket as cricket grew. Absolutely. And Farokh was in the middle of all that, being an Indian in Lancashire. You know, I think what they've seen, and he's making light of everything, but you know, there were all kinds of things that they had to deal with. And of course, then he went on to run Manchester. If you want tickets to anything, football, cricket, rugby, anything in Manchester, you just say Farokh Ridikra. That's all you have to say.
You know,
and they all understand basic Gujarati.
I'll be very honest with you. Some Indians have actually flown in to Manchester Airport without a bloody visa and mentioned that they're staying at Farokh Engineer's house and they're friends of mine and they've been allowed to come into the country. Perhaps they've never left or I don't know. But they've actually told me, tomorrow naam deina aavegi andar. They actually let them. I mean, this is a few years ago. I don't think it would happen now.
That's a great idea when you're filling those forms.
I know.
Just find a famous person and just dial the name onto that.
Yeah, because Manchester is a small place. There are a lot of sportsmen. There's how many football teams are here? Manchester United, Manchester City, Liverpool, Everton, Bolton. I mean, surrounded by sportsmen. So at functions, there are a lot of charity functions. We all meet regularly. And one of my dearest, dearest, dearest buddies, what a guy called George Best. Have you heard of George Best?
Oh, God, the legend.
George and I were sick. He loved Indian food. You know, the salu invariably, you know, he was an Irishman. And he loved a good drink and a good time.
So who is better? Who is better, the two things that he was famous for as well?
Curb furniture.
Ladies and beer.
Kavanu, I was.
Kavanu, 100%. Pivanu, because both of you are legendary.
I think we were both on
neck and neck.
Yeah,
neck and neck. And the last one, Ramvanu.
I would say fairly neck and neck. Because
are you serious? You were up there with George Best.
Both of us had two Miss Worlds as our girlfriends.
Wow.
You know,
it's excellent. Silvery, who the hell are we, man? Look at what they've done. So I mean, you play for India, you travel the world.
From what I hear, you're not doing too badly.
No. I'm happy here. Bairi, Bairi, Bairi no birthday cha. 50 today. So he's just made a half century. I tried to doff, but it's not working. What's without Viagra.
What's her name?
Aisha.
Aisha, I wish you a very, very happy birthday. You might be a great man here.
I don't think so.
And wish you all the best.
Silver, you see the pressure on your generation. Two Miss Indias. And George happy, Best, happy. One of the greats of football. Farokh Engineer, one of the greats of cricket. So they've already got that going for them. And they beat you at everything else. Even in pleasure. We lose to them in pleasure, brother. That's ridiculous.
That's I believe so we're terrible. Having a Q&A session as well.
Yes, Q&A starting right now.
Yes. We have tons of questions, tons of comments. But before that, we have to address something. Saurabh Pant is in the chat. And he has said that Cyrus's internet is worse than Varun Thakur's. Because Cyrus, your video keeps lagging. Can we explain to the people why your internet is not as great today?
Yeah, because, it's a long story. The short of it is that we got them to the speed. The upload speed is slow.
Yeah.
In spite of us paying. And I don't have the pull of a Farokh engineer in Manchester where one name can just get things done. I've repeatedly called Jio. They've come here and I don't know now. They said they did it. It went up to 30 or 40 MGBT, RST, LDD, YMG. Q, whatever the hell it is, and apparently nothing's changed, so that's why he's in Manchester and we're still here because of Wi-Fi. Yeah, but Saurabh, I'm sorry, we're dealing with it now. We are going to invest more money. I'm going to move right next to the Jio headquarters and sit outside with a small laptop and try and do it from there. I think that's the only thing left now.
Who's Varun Thakur, by the way?
He's a very big stand-up comedian and a molester. He's known to molest a lot of people, and so there's a lot of action.
No, I'm just kidding.
He's not a molester. Yeah. He's a sweet guy. But Varun is also a Parsi name, so we don't know. Maybe he's half Parsi. I don't know.
Yeah.
All right. Questions?
Yeah. Questions. First one is from Toto. He says, ask Farokh about the portrait in the background, please. There's a portrait of
Famous.
Yeah. That's a picture. It's a painting. A very famous artist in England has done it for me. Yeah, I didn't know that was there in the background. This is my little study, you know. I play a lot of bridge on my computer. I play bridge every day, every afternoon, in fact. And that was a bridge club calling me. They said, where am I today? I said, I'm doing it, you know. I'm talking about the great Cyrus here.
I'm just trying to see the hairy chest. And is the sideburn visible? I think it is.
I think so.
So was that was a big hit then, wasn't it?
Yeah. You don't compare before and after. That's the main thing, you know.
Yeah. Been there, done that. In the words of the great engineer. All right. Next one.
Yeah. Next one comes in from Kashin Shetty. He says, good evening, Cyrus and Farokh sir. Between the 1983 and the 2011 World Cup wins for India, which do you feel was more glorious and more difficult for us to win? He says, I know the answer, but just want to hear it from your...
Yeah, it's an easy answer. Farokh, engineer.
Well, 83 World Cup was, was one of the greatest things that happened. I think there are two things that happened in Indian cricket. 71.
Yes.
Victory, you know.
West Indies and England.
West Indies and England and the 83 World Cup. I think these are the two things that set the benchmark for a lot of cricketers to happen. That they set the benchmark for IPL to take place and all these things, you know. But I mean, for me, those two, you know, that just overshadowed the 2011 World Cup. But which was a great thing. You know, Dhoni did a tremendous job there. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I felt proud once again of being an Indian.
There was a third thing. In my generation, there was happy days are here again, thumbs up. An ad which ran with Sunny, Ravi Shastri, Dilip Vengsarkar, Sandeep Patil. And I thought that overstayed its welcome. It ran for about 10, 12 years without stopping.
I've never seen that. But
then you had moved to England, so I don't think you got to see it. But it just went on and on.
Sure.
So that was another glorious moment.
As long as they were referring to the drink, you know.
Yeah, well, Sandy took a lot of catches in the ad, and they used to make fun that he doesn't take the catches on the pitch.
No. He wasn't renowned for his fielding.
But coming back to that 83 thing, I think what you pointed out, which we must stress, is that nobody gave India a chance, you know, or 71 for that matter. Yeah. That's the beauty of that is it's against
really
the run of play. Literally.
Really speaking, the West Indies, the form that they were in, I think they were very complacent. That they're chasing only a low score. They'll easily get it. You know, if I don't get the run, somebody else will get it. You know, so if Viv Richards was out, they thought there's so many other, there's Clive Lloyd and all that. But all of them collectively failed. You know, apart from that, we put a lot of pressure on them. Once we started getting the early initial wickets. My word, we should have never been in the finals. We should have not even qualified because we should have lost at Canterbury to Zimbabwe, to lowly place Zimbabwe.
17 for year. 4. Kapil 13 for 4. Yeah.
Got a tremendous innings he played. I couldn't believe it. I was jumping out of my commentator's box. Commentator's box and the dressing room were always next to each other. So I was always in the Indian dressing room, trying to cheer with the boys. You know, come on, we can do it. And we got runs on the board. They have yet to get them. So, you know, things like that. Try and encourage the boys. Give them confidence.
Yeah. I mean, you're hearing from Farokh, who's a generation before seeing India win a World Cup. And then for us guys growing up, I was like 11 years old and hearing on the radio and they would, the patchy TV, it would go and come. Richards got out, in fact, when the TV, they took it off for news or something. I can't remember. And Richards gets out there and 33 or 28 balls. And while he was batting, the match was over. I mean, he was just dismissive, you know, in his languid way. And it was just dead. And then suddenly Kapil Dev plucks a ball out of the sky and I remember people went berserk. I have seen that reaction
Kapil
again.
Kapil caught Viv Richards, that was a crucial catch. And then
a
bowler like Mohinder Amarnath, I mean, you'd play a bowler like, you'd hit sixes at will with a bowler that pace.
You know, that's a bit mean. Yeah.
But all credit to him. He bowled a very good line and length. You know, and I think he was man of the match for that thing. Because he got, you know,
runs he did.
And wickets.
Runs and wickets, yeah. So all holding at the end.
Yeah, well, all credit to him because he very well. So, I mean, naturally, I was elated because no one gave us a chance, as you said earlier. And winning,
you know, and Farokh, look at the legendary lineup. I mean, at least for what I've seen in cricket, the greatest team ever. I mean, you just look at them one after another. Greenidge, Haynes, Richards, Lloyd.
Ever. Is that your good lady?
That's my wife. She's the Farokh engineer.
Happy birthday.
She's 50 today. Yeah.
You don't look.
Survive the mad person.
Yeah.
You don't look.
He says you don't look it. Now you behave yourself, Mr. Engineer. Ah, kapi nak se. Ban ki do.
Mara bhaiji bhaiji se, yeah.
Silvery, I told him I'll cut it off.
There's not much to cut off these days.
Let's stay back on track. Yeah, just quickly. So you're saying not the best team, Lloyd's 80s? Not the best team you saw?
No.
Then who was more powerful?
Far, far, far better teams in the past.
You know? Except for Bradman's Invincibles, who would you put above?
Well, the 48 Australian team was...
Yeah, the Invincibles.
But I would say the present Indian team is as strong as any now. But I think I believe the boys left for England last night in a charter plane.
Right. Because we got the money, Farokh. We got the money.
Money. But with the Indian variant over here, quite prevalent in certain parts, you know. I mean, in spite of that, I feel they're going to be in a bubble for 5 months now.
106 days,
Cyrus, I was in Dubai for the last IPL,
right?
And the Bangalore Royal Challengers were staying in the same hotel,
right,
as me. And I met a guy who was connected with the team. I didn't recognize as a player, so I just asked him, "What was he doing?" He said he was a resident comedian. I swear to God. So they had a comedian with the team.
Oh, to help the morale.
To help the morale. You know, they should have had you here in England, sir.
What happened to the old-fashioned striptease, Farokh? Would you want a comedian like me? Or would you like two Miss Worlds?
You need someone to cheer you up and to see the bright side of things. A real optimist.
It's horrible. I can't... And then they have to stay locked in for the first 10 days.
It's going to be very hard.
Yeah.
You know, the young Parsi boy, I believe, you know, with the team as well.
We're all very excited. He's a net bowler for now, but that's a big... Yeah. I mean, Mumbai Indians have picked him up. So there's a chance that he can go further. We'll all push. We'll pull our user influence and Tatas will make phone calls and Godrejis will come to the fore. It's about... we have to fight for our own, right, Silvery?
Absolutely. That's
the nature of the beast.
Nobody else will fight for us.
There you go. Yeah, it's lovely to see, but just imagine...
I spoke to him. I did a little chat show with him for
some
television interview. First time I saw him in person.
Naam suche?
Arzan. Arzan Nagwaswala.
Nagwaswala. Correct.
Now,
correct.
I said toro naam Arzan che. But in a couple of years, I'm going to transform that Arzan into Tarzan.
Wow!
I told him that. He was laughing. I said, I want you to... At the moment, you're a net bowler, but... have that confidence, learn a lot from the thing, talk to... If I get a chance over here, I'll introduce him to people like Wasim Akram and all, who are very dear friends of mine. They live in Manchester, you see. So with this bubble, you don't know what's going to happen. But if I can help the youngster in any way, I'd be only too delighted to do so. Not only because of Parsi, but any youngster for that matter.
But Farokh, it's very simple. All he has to do is hit Virat or Rohit on the helmet in the nets a couple of times, and they'll remember him forever. It's very possible.
They'll probably send him back home for that. Any more questions?
Quickly, one last one.
There are a couple more, because there are quite a few.
I know.
That's fine. Next one is from Arthik Shetty. He says, my question is that, is there any current cricketer who reminds Mr. Engineer of himself in terms of playing style and personality?
Well, not current, but MS Dhoni was the closest that came to, to remembering me. Rishabh Pant to a certain extent, yes. You know, the same personality, the same smiling.
The swagger, the devil may care, sort of buccaneer approach to batting.
The sheer enjoyment you get out of playing the game. Because if you're enjoying him, and you're cool about it, it is very infectious to the rest of your teammates. They will all enjoy it. And you're creating a lasting impression with the spectators, with the crowds. Then look, he's playing a serious game of cricket, but he's still smiling and he's still enjoying it. And it's wonderful to see that. And you can only give off your best when you're relaxed and all that. So thank you very much to my friend who's asked me that question. So I think Dhoni and Rishabh Pant are the two that remind me.
Best Indian keeper, Farokh? Controversial question.
Silly question, isn't it?
Well, come on, you're a great judge. Who do you think? Who has the best hands, line and length, anticipation?
Well, let's put it this way. That
yourself excused, of course.
I mean, now you answered the question there. You got to have confidence in your ability. When you're picked for the World 11 as number one wicketkeeper in the world, and my deputies being people like Alan Knott, Bob Taylor, Rod Marsh.
Wow.
I mean, that shows foreigners, you're not respected in your own country, in fact. You know what? We try and put you down in our country. I never forget, we had one commentator, a very eminent commentator. I'll mention his name, Vijay Merchant, for example.
Ooh.
He dropped me and Pataudi from the West Indies tour. I was captain for the West Indies tour in 71.
Right. Right.
I was captain. I was invited to Bombay to be co-opted on the committee. And suddenly I was asked that I play county cricket in England. I said, yes, I do. But I play all Ranji Trophy matches, all Duleep Trophy matches, and everything. You know, so what is your problem? The problem is, you're far too flamboyant. You and Pataudi are too flamboyant. I said, is that a criticism or a praise? No, it's not right. You know, flamboyance, there shouldn't be any flamboyancy sort of, and for that reason, And one or two other three. I just walked out of the committee room there. I said, you invited me, you paid my airfare to Bombay, you know, and you asked me this question now, after me being sort of more or less officially told that I'm captain for the tour. And now what are you trying to say? We're trying to say that you shouldn't be eligible for captaincy. I said, okay. Am I eligible to play for the team? And they shook their heads and said, well, we have doubts about that, you know. So I just walked out of the room. I said, thank you very much for wasting my time and yours. I went, I hadn't even unpacked my bags. I was staying at CCI. I just zipped the bags up, went to the airport and took a flight back to England. I was so dejected. Okay, this is the way our own people treat you, you know. And I just come back from Australia with the World 11, you know, as the number one wicketkeeper batsman in the world. And this is the way to be treated. I thought this is bad news. You know, but we have a tendency of doing that. I've heard from several other sportsmen, I won't name them, that they try and pull you down in our own country because of jealousy or whatever.
This is just the nature of the personality issue. It's not about your cricket.
Why? I would be only too glad someone from India came and did something. Like Vijay Amrit Raj, very dear friend of mine, you know, played tennis. I'm so proud that an Indian is there, you know, holding the tricolor flag. But unfortunately, not many people think the same way.
So what Silvery Farokh is saying is he was like the Vijay Mallya of that generation in cricket. They were known for their, they really were. They were like, you know, They really had one day. Maybe he'll release a book about what happened outside the. He's in London.
Yeah,
he's safely ensconced in London for now.
Oh yes.
Perhaps more wrong than wrong. Yes, king of good times. All right, let's squeeze one more in.
Yeah, sure. Last one comes in from Shash P. He or could be a she actually asks. Since we have two famous Parsis, can we ask each of them their all-time top five favorite Parsi actors in the Bollywood industry?
We'll do that, but first, don't put me in the same bracket as the Farokh Engineer is an actual legend. The tangible qualities of talent, and people don't understand. I wish people follow the history of Indian cricket because I hate people who don't understand the heroes from the past. And I mean, he's another pedestal. Farokh, please, I refuse to be put in the same breath as you. I'm an out-of-work actor. You're a legend.
No, only one Parsi actor in the Bollywood industry, and that's Bhavan Irani. I mean, have you acted in films, Cyrus?
I have, but there's also John Abraham, whose mother is very much Irun, a dog lover, and everything else, football crazy. Liverpool nutcase.
I didn't know he was a Parsi.
Speaks perfect Gujarati. He talks with a little tota also. Perfect.
I was with him on a flight.
He didn't tell you he's half Baba. He's brought up like a Baba. Everything is Baba about him.
Really? I admire his acting. Now,
can he be that good looking? Farokh, what kind of question is that? Now, come on.
Now you hit the nail on the head. I didn't realize John Abrams was Parsi, but we take pride. Even one Tipu of Parsi, we'll take pride.
Yeah. It's a Parsi. Rahul Gandhi is 1/8 Parsi.
Of course.
He's going to make a comeback.
Yeah, but which are the parts?
And he's a great actor.
Actresses are there. Well done, Silvery.
Which actresses out of the ground. Are there?
Which part? Amaira Dastoor, Perizad, Perizad Zorabian.
Persis Khambhata.
Persis Khambhata from the past, yes.
Yes. And so you are very bad. Well, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Then Sajid Khan and Farah Khan mothers are Parsi. Irun again, Dolly. I think Dolly Irani's Dolly or okay. Honey Irani. Honey Irani's children.
Okay, right.
Famous. So the whole Irani girls.
Iranis are all the same.
No. Yeah, same. And they were all three of them were in the business. The Irani sisters of yesteryear.
Yeah.
Oh, John Kawas. I researched this. The very first Bollywood hero is a guy called John Kawas. It was a silent era. In the late 20s. And super bodybuilder.
You're showing your age, Cyrus. You know?
Yeah. I like all these silly pieces of information. This is why I don't get laid, Farokh. I have these ridiculous conversations with women.
Pardon? You don't get...
I don't.
Hey, this is a family show. You know?
I know, but I just feel so bad. You and George Best. Silvery, will you explain? he's very polite in front of anyone older than him. It's a different personality with others. Huh? No, chalo, are we done? Idea. Do we say goodbye to good night? Rather? Yep. Not good night. It's afternoon lunchtime.
Thoroughly enjoyed this, Cyrus. I'm glad I broke my bridge for a change and been great talking to you. Antrix, thank you very much for your.
Thank you so much.
I thank Anna D'Souza because she's been a great person to liaise with in between. You know, give my regards to her, or if she's listening, thank you.
As we say bye to you, any message to Sunny in case we meet him since he's not too far away from me?
Yes, Dikra. He calls me Dikra.
Yeah.
So whenever we were in Detroit a couple of years ago, and we were in the car coming from a certain function, and we saw a restaurant called Dikra, and Sunny pointed to me, "Hey, sala, apro restaurant check in Dikra." He's always Gujarati? Called me Dikra.
Was it Gujarati Dikra or something else?
No, I don't know. We didn't go to that place. But it said Dikra, maybe selling something else. So when you see Sunny, give him my very warm regards. My Dikra. He sends me messages. I send him. And we finish with Dix, short for Dikra.
Perhaps too much information for this young boy. Silvery, shut your ears. Listen, it's been an absolute pleasure and honor, Farokh. Thank you so much for being with us. And hopefully we can get you back whenever there's a serious cricket going on involving India as well.
I hope so, because Anna spoke the possibility of that. I would love. I think we'd make
be great.
A great, you know, we'd, on the lighter side of cricket, we'd discuss some serious cricket issues, as well as make it into a lighthearted program. And I think it'll go like a bomb. It'll go like a treat.
I was thinking more that I would live off the conquest, relive the best years.
Let's do it, Cyrus. Let's do it.
you can combine, you be the alpha wolf and I'll follow.
We can combine the
There
wolf.
You go. There you go.
You take care. My love to your parents.
Cheers. Thank you so much, Farokh. All the best to you. Bye-bye.
Thank you,
guys.
All the best.